which is very important substance for fusion. Now, we have the law, we have the outer space treaty, and the outer space treaty say that the moon cannot explode here. But at the present time, some companies, private companies in the United States say that the moon treaty cover only the surface of the moon, not the material down there. So we have another treaty, it's the moon treaty. The moon treaty say that helium is a kind of fish in the sea. Anyone who can grab, you can go and get it. So the private company in the United States is even contemplating to send private rockets to the moon and to bring the helium back to the Earth. So we have to think about the law and how can we form that situation. Now, I would like to invite the third speaker, Dr. Apara.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. First of all, I would like to express my sincere thanks to Renzi University for inviting me here and be the most beautiful ladies on stage. Can't help all of you already began. And already the MC mentioned that we should stay in the very, very like informal atmosphere. Please feel relaxed. Dr. Anusorn told me that please go deep down to our institute experience for the response of the disruptive technology. So I would like to inform you a bit and then we can share. This already mentioned for the overview of the disruptive technology, very famous about the McKinsey Global Institute, already mentioned and touched upon by Ajahn Sutipola. Yes. It's very interesting, but I would like to express here that it's the world trend, but maybe not all for Thailand. And how it impacts, of course, implication for individual and societies, already mentioned a bit by Ajahn Sutipola. For our life, our health and environmental, of course, for the pattern of consumption. So right now we can, so many e-shopping. Also, we can do our work anywhere in the world, as well as we take leisure at the same time. Apart from that, about the implication, we can see a lot for the establishment of the businesses and organization. I would like to mention here that about the creation of new product, service, market, and business. Dr. Sutipon showed us already and how can we manage, how can we cope with this disruptive technology. In my case, I would like to touch a lot for me on the changes in organizational structure. Apart from that, economies and government, of course, right now so many countries in the world have a very, very wide expansion of the economy. For example, China, of course, from the disruptive technology that we can see. Not only disruptive technology that affects the mission. The most nearby our side is the Thailand new engine of growth, including government agenda. I would like to mention that this government is very, very active. Sometimes I have been thinking they have like a daily initiatives. So many initiatives launched. Yeah. So you can see that the red circle indicated that it's in line with disruptive technology. So like an advanced robot for the new S-curve, renewable energy. Yeah. And for the indigenous aspect, of course, the autonomous vehicle or modern vehicle. And one of the big platforms that we have to develop for our country, and it will support all the rest of the S-curve, is the digital that already includes mobile internet, automation, IoT, and cloud technology. Not only that, we also have to conduct our work under the SDG goal. So you can see the main purpose of our government is eradication of the poverty, no poverty, and of course energy, and etc. You can see industry innovation and infrastructure. So many things, climate action, yes, of course, life on land, below water. All the things have to be the same picture and put together to push forward for our Thailand for sustainable development. In the case of TISTA, we already have our own concept. We have OZONE concept. The first O means opportunity for new business. It means like no poverty. So you can see the linkage. Zero means zero waste management. So we can see we have green innovation, green technology. Yes, we have to conduct our R&D and technology transfer under this concept. The second O means occupation. It means that we have to create the occupation in line with our R&D and also for technology transfer. And of course, N is the natural resource base. So right now it's very, very actively launched propaganda about the bio-based economy. And lastly is the energy efficiency. Of course, energy is one of the major costs for the production. We have to focus more on its efficiency use. Right now, I will focus more and more impact from the disruptive technology, government initiatives, and sustainable development goal on TISTA function. Firstly, I would like to introduce you about TISTA, Thailand Institute of Scientific and Technological Research. TISTA is a 54 years old non-profit state enterprise under the Ministry of Science and Technology. State enterprise means we have labor union. Can you imagine about the function and how we can align with the labor union and under our RDI mission? Our vision is a leading organization in the education of STI for the creation of a sustainable innovation-based society. Very, very in line with all the national policy. Our mission is conduct R&D in STI for value adding of products and service, provide science and technical service, transfer of technology and innovation to industry and community enterprises, and of course, develop an effective organizational management system fast. We have to have like a sense of urgency to quick respond to this government. All these things, you can see all the external factor and our long story. So right now, the average age of our staff is about 43, a bit old. So it's our grand challenge. How can we change? How can we respond to all these challenges for the fast and fruitful responses, not fast and furious? Of course, mainly I think you are mainly for the Lancet University is the bio-based. So you learn a lot about the species of fitness of the Darwin. But right now it's not evolution. We have to survive. It's the revolution, not disruption. Just only revolution. And we have to make like a 360 degree adaptation to catch. This is maybe the only opportunity that STI was raised with a very, very high rank of the important for the national economic driver. Is our big burden, our big mission. So TISTA have to change tremendously. I cannot tell you how, but of course, starting from our organization structure, it's very long period because we have labor union. We have to adjust all the plan, our technology roadmap for RDI service and technology transfer include all the internal process, and of course it's not an easy solution. How? But I would like to focus just only under my responsibility for the Sustainable Development Group. Formerly, we have four departments for energy, environment, engineering, and material. But right now, for the organizational structure reforming, we combine energy and environment to be a quite a big lab, big center to quick and integrate all the activity, because energy have to go along well with environment. And another is material and inno robot. Inno mean expert innovation center of energy, material and robot and automation like that. We have to focus more and more on commercialization and contract research. Of course, we actually enjoy contract research. It's a problem shooting from private sector and industry. And of course, if we use the budget from the in-house, we try to find and scaling up our project by using the private budget. We have to share our infrastructure with private sectors. And of course, we cannot get innovation from the traditional organization. So we have to change our organization to be innovation in the innovation ecosystem and set up the open innovation network. This is like our objective and mission. So to show you just only love the idea, right now we have, this is quite one of the biggest center, but we have just only 78 staff with only 14 PhD. And this is the variation of our staff background, research background, and also education. It's quite wide range, that's why we can conduct integrate activity and do synergy R&D and technology transfer. And this is to introduce you just a bit on our part of preparation. This is the center for the prototype of the synthetic fuel production from biomass. And this is another one in Lam Ta Kong to be the demonstration plant. This is our infrastructure for the pilot plant for H-frame or high-quality biofuel production, pyrolyzer, gasifier, and also plasma. Our instrument and for analytical for both R&D and service. And this is for testing service in the field of energy. This is for the field of environment. And this is the thing that we prepare, as already mentioned, sometimes external factor change our landscape of work. For example, the third generation biofuel from LG. Formerly is very, very actively, and we can see financial support, not so difficult, but right now, after shale gas and oil, the picture changed a lot, so we have to change not only for biofuel production, but also another value added by biochemicals. And this is the thing that I mentioned. We have to join and gain money. For example, we have the technology for changing of biogas to be biomethanol, that all are work are important. And as we increase the biodiesel production, we have to use methanol in that process. So right now, we try to scale it up from the pilot scale in the laboratory to be expand from 100 milliliter or 10 milliliter per day to be like a 1 liter per day. And in this case, luckily we can find the private sector that owner of the biogas power plant, many power plant, for many kind of raw materials, both starch and palm oil, and they try to use our technology, and maybe we will have a contract signing this month. And yes, of course, this is like a small scale. And another thing, that's the thing that we have to do for the disruptive technology for renewable energy And this is another, it's like a government agenda to deal with the waste management, especially for the small size, tend to be waste to energy or another useful appliance. And this is another thing to be in line with the sustainable development goal. We have a Skylight and Rain Research Station, which was designated as UNESCO Biosphere Reserve. And technology translation with the UKM that we chain already established a technology and it does work. Yeah. Like this, the production of a fertilizer from the fixing cell bacteria will be transferred from TISTA to UKM, and this color life of palm oil meal effluent from UKM to TISTA. And this is one of the shortcuts. We have to make an open innovation system via a collaboration network. This is the thing that we try to set. And of course, maybe they mention a lot about a triple helix, but in our case, because we deal a lot on energy and environment, so not only triple helix, we have to concern more on international, regional collaboration, and of course, communication and civil society, because so many protests against biomass plant, power plant like that, and etc. in the case of environment as well. So that's all my talk that I would like to share for the first round. Thank you very much, Dr.
Ozone concept, biogas and waste management. So we have the last speaker, which from the industry, so he can give us the views from the industrial side. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you, Vice President, distinguished speakers, distinguished participants. Good morning to you all. As the last speaker, actually, that's a very appropriate, because I came without any slides, any presentation. So I pick up from each of the previous speakers. That's the usual way of my speaking. I think it's very interesting. I would like to bring you back to the topic of this discussion, and that is the post-21st century disruptive technology. Now, we are in the 21st century. So post-21st century means about 84 years from now. That's after 2099. That's a very long way. And we can hardly see past 2030. Now we are looking at 2030, the government is trying to bring Thailand up to the level of developed country, perhaps in 2035. And that's something that we can still visualize. But 2099, I think by that time, the post, the disruptive technology, judging from the statistics of the demography of Thailand and perhaps in other countries as well, the disruptive technology at that time would be the female population of that sitting among us. Why? Because if you look at the statistics of the students in university and high school, you'll notice that the women outnumber the male students, maybe about 64. That's a very interesting observation, and I think many people are looking at it with some interest. I think Dr. Narathapon was correct in bringing up Hypatia, because that is one of the classic example of a very famous lady who was obscure by the male chauvinism for so long. So I think it's about time that we recognize the capability and the ability of the female members of our society. The other day when I was at a conference, regarding the role of female in Thailand 4.0. And incidentally, the Thailand 4.0, you might recognize that we were talking about the phases of economic development of Thailand since the agricultural world as the Thailand 1.0, the light industry is the Thailand 2.0, and heavy industry and longer supply chain export dependent as Thailand 3.0, and we are looking forward to Thailand 4.0. At the same time, the role of the female side of our society is also changing. It's also changing. From the first time, the Thailand 1.0, the agricultural world, I would say that the role of female at that time was in Thai word, you know, chang kao lang. That means the hind leg of the elephant. You know, really, at that time, it was really the role of male to be outside to do most of the work outside of home, where the ladies stay home and tend to the family. That's by no means less important, but it's very important as well. You can imagine an elephant with only two front legs. You know how it looked. That would look really ridiculous. Yeah? And the second, I would say the second phase of Thailand 2.0. The role of female during that era is actually summarized easily as chantana. You know, the female start to go out and work in factories, you know, but mostly in the labor intensive work. So that's the role of female during the Thailand 2.0. And in Thailand 3.0, you can find that actually now is still the Thailand 3.0 era. You can find that you can say that the ladies, the female side of our population, is what I describe as kiem ba, kiem la. It's more or less the same. You know, the role of female and male in the Thai society is more or less the same. And in the Thailand 4.0 then, what do I visualize? I visualize that the women in the Thailand 4.0 era would be called gao gai ne lo guan. That means go out and explore your wide world. So, chang kao lang, chang ta na, kien ba kien lai, and gao bai ni lo guan. That's the role of the Thailand, the women in the Thailand 1, 2, 3, and 4. So if you ask me, the disruptive technology in the post-21st century would be the female side of our population. That would disrupt the male. So that's my visualization of the post 21st century. But if we are talking about the 21st century, there are many technology that is being described as disruptive technology, but all of them stem from what I would put the blame on the revolution of the digital technology. If you are as old as I am, you will realize that there are so many things that has gone out of style and has gone out of usage. Ajahn talked about telegraph. Telegraph. I'm coming up with another thing, the gramophone. Have you seen the gramophone? Not many of you. Dr. Sudipan showed is just the tape cassette, it's cassette tapes. But I go back further to the gramophone. You know, the other day there was a fire in the Fortune Town building, and that store, a very famous store for gramophone records, you know, was burned. That's such a pity. But that is a very classic example of the difference between analog and digital technology. Analog technology, of course, it assimilates the human brain. Human brain is still analog, unfortunately. We cannot pack so many memory into the brain because it learns, it records, store information through recognition, through assimilation. So it's very difficult to pack so much information into the brain. But when we are talking about digital information, that's quite different. Even though when we try to assimilate the digital data to be more like the analog data, that's the first generation of digital recording for music, for example. And people said that, people was always criticizing that the digital music was hard, it was not very refined, it doesn't sound so good, you know, and it will never go far in the society. But now, look at what Steve Jobs had done. You know, he invented the iPod, and everybody ditched their tape cassettes. And I have all these records. You must be joking. I have maybe another 30 minutes to talk about, because if you're talking about industry, there's so many things. But for the revolution from the digital, from the analog to digital technology, have created so many things. Recently, PricewaterhouseCoopers, the PwC, had come up with the 8 technologies that will be very important, would be vital to industrial revolution in this century. And those are AI, artificial intelligence, you know that. We are talking about the big data and everything. So AI would be indispensable, because without AI, the big data is no use. AR, augmented reality, of course. Recently, the games and everything, you know, they talk about the augmented reality. Blockchain. Blockchain is something that could put lawyers out of work, although we were talking about exploring on the moon. perhaps determining who owns what on the moon, and that requires the use of a lawyer, perhaps. But with the coming of blockchain, perhaps lawyers will no longer be needed. All the contracts can be done through blockchains. Right? Drones. You know, drones is very important, and now you can use drones in everything. Delivery, home delivery, and you can also use it in the farming even. So drone technology would also be very vital to industry. IoT, everybody knows IoT, the Internet of Things. So everyone is gearing up towards the IoT. Previously, it would be very difficult to come by an IoT device, but they were saying that in not many years from now, there would be about 70 billion pieces of IoT devices. So imagine we have about 7 billion people in the world. Each one will own about 10. So you can imagine what these devices will be, and will invade into our daily lives. VR, virtual reality. Of course, right now, there are so many things that are being done virtually instead of actually. For example, testing. I visited Siemens not too long ago, and instead of doing the physical testing of their equipment or of their components, they're now doing what they call the digital twins. That means that a program computer that will do the testing, given the design, the graphic file of the components that you are testing. So VR is coming, and very important. 3D, the last one, 3D printer. You know, three-dimensional printer is coming, and it brings not only the pages to home through faxes or remote printing. Now you can send particles, you can send actual things to homes through the digital network. So if you look at all these technologies, you know, they are all digital, and they all stem from the technical revolution. In industry, now I'm just starting. In industry, we are talking about industry 4.0, all right? Industry 1 is, of course, the steam engine. You know, it takes the place of the animals and human efforts, human labor. So that's the first revolution for industry. The second one, of course, is the electricity. And Thomas Alva Edison, Mr. Faraday, for example, you know, then created the electricity, the light bulbs, and most of all, that affects the industry most of all is the electric motor. The electric motor and the conveyor belts, that creates the mass production of the industry in the Industry 2.0 revolution. The third, of course, is the automation, and was inspired, it was made possible by the invention of the computers, the digital computer that was about 60 or 70 years ago invented. Now the fourth industry revolution will come at the heel of the digital revolution because it's the manufacturing on the platform of digital technology. It's an industry where all the machines will talk to each other, and instead of human being in control, they would be in control, but they report all production data back to human, and human will only be monitoring everything because the controls will also be related to the machinery. So this the evolution of the Industry 4.0 is something that the Federation is pondering, because we feel that in order for Thailand to get out of the middle income trap into a really developed country nation, we need to increase the productivity of our industry. Currently, industry accounts for about 40%, 42% of our GDP. In order to maintain the 42, or perhaps increase it a little bit to 45%, perhaps we should be moving towards the Industry 4.0 and to increase the productivity and efficiency of the Industry 4.0. Of course, the human resource would have to be adjusting themselves, and if they have to learn new skills, and I wish that education institutes such as Ransom University and many other in our nation can help in reskilling, retooling our labor force for the future. That's perhaps the only time I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I agree with him that nowadays women outperform men in several aspects. And legally speaking, I'm not so sure whether it should be called disruptive technologies or disruptive societies. And at the same time, I would like to know if we have more time for question and answer. 10 minutes. Okay. Then I just would like to open the floor for questions from the audience. And it depends on the subject matters and on the willingness of the speaker who will respond to that question. Please, the floor is yours.
The big thing, I think, is one aspect that no one mentions about the political impact of this subject technology. At least in Thailand, I think that there are many impacts. The first, I think that the government provide our target or our destination that called Thailand 4.0. This is very important that because of the recognized about innovation and subject technology. The second one is about the collaboration between the public and the private, or public and community called Prashara. This is very important that in the past, possible for disruptive technology. The third one is we call it the boom, the Buranakan, the old boom. Because we all work independently, it cannot be successful. The other thing about the political impact of the disruptive technologies is about the internet. So government set up the e-government database of big data and services that will be very important in everything. Taxation, revenue, everything will be based on e-government database. about the research and development. The government agrees with the National Research Council of Thailand right now, or maybe a few years before this research funding. It's not just only for government sector, but also will be provided to the private sector, including the private university as well. So this is during time. But anyway, I would like to say that I don't agree with Jane that human brain is just analog. Remember, it's very, very sophisticated and super digital. And if we can duplicate the brain function, we may expect that we can find many disruptive technologies.
Okay. Is there any questions? If not, I think so. Okay, yes, please.
Good morning. My name is Kathy Turkopo. I'm from the Faculty of Accountancy. And I'm the lady from the Four Point Group. Well, thanks for the talk this morning. And I'd like to say that we are well aware of this disruptive technology and also so overwhelmed with these changes. I'd like to ask a question, actually two questions, that in terms of like we are as the professors at the university, how could we prepare ourselves for this changing technology? Because all the courses have to catch up with this technology, right? And like for accounting, for finance, for business, it's like so much changing nowadays. That's my first question in terms of education. The second question is about the government point of view. You're saying that we, the organization has the 360 degree adaptation. I personally don't see much of that, that the government may well aware of that. But for like a normal citizen like myself, I don't quite see that yet. Maybe you have done so a lot of things about this. For the business changing, like WeChat, like all the business done online for the e-commerce, how the government does in terms of, say for example, the tax collection. You know, the other day I talked with the tax guy, they said that there's no such system to catch up with this debt. And I just wanted to raise these two questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your very interesting question. How to prepare? I would like to mention about just only one image, Rocking Doll. Maybe regarding your mission, you have to prepare your student to be Rocking Doll. They have to be resilient. They can be moved but not collapse for the quick response to all the challenges. External factor or internal factor. That's overall picture that I would like to give lovely. And in the case of for the 360 degree for the change, because maybe the other is still not have to do as much as teacher. Most of them are new establishment, but in our case, quite over half century. So we have to change a lot, starting from the mindset of our staff. They have to come out of comfort zone. The most of the important thing that they have to do, quick response and in line with all the level of policy under our platform. Under our platform, not based on their own interests. Apart from conducting RDI, service and technology transfer, they have to have business mind as well. They have to learn about market. They have to know the driver. What's the driver? That's the thing that we have to learn, not only our S&T and gain our experience just only for the research. but we have to learn all the 44 areas that have to support our work to make all the result turn to be the real utilization. Commercialize in any level, for the auto, for the SME, or even the big firm, and of course for the community, like that. But it have to be touchable result, commercialized. That's the thing that we have to know. So we have to learn along the stream, from the upstream to the downstream. Not only finish our project, not just only demonstration. After demonstration, how can we expand to be the real production firm, production manufacturing like that? So, as I mentioned, it's totally 360 degree, not only size anymore. Yes.
So the first question, Dr. Narottam, you have to be honest.
Thank you for very interesting questions. For me, as a lecturer, also a lecturer in the university, and as a director of a research institute, so I would like to emphasize every attempt to change the role from a lecturer to a peer coach of the student and learn with the student, okay? Learn together. And I try to encourage every attempt to change the classroom, the lecture room, to the co-working space or the arena for discussions. So it is possible for a graduate school, but it may or may not feasible for a large 3,000 students in the lecture room. I'm not sure about how what is the way to optimize for teaching university, but. For the research university, actually you can change the floor to the discussion floor, and you change your role to a peer coach or a coach for the students.
Can I add a little? I have a very short answer to your question. In the business world, in order to survive in a fast-changing world, lead the change. You don't stay behind the change and try to chase the change. You lead the change. You make things happen. You make things that you imagine would happen. Look at Steve Jobs. Very, very classic example. You know, who invented the iPhone? Steve Jobs. He said that he's not waiting for the result of a customer survey. You know, he knows beforehand what product will be popular among his customers. So he lead the change. SCG, for a Thai example, and then led the change in the R&D work, and now they're reaping the benefits. But I fully agree with Dr. Narottam that being a lecturer, you need not to be a teacher anymore, because the contents can be found everywhere. It's in the air, you know? So what happened is that instead of in addition to the being a coach, also because you know the subject so well, you need to be the inspirer as well. You need to transfer your love, your passion for the subject that you're teaching to your students, so that they can love, they can be passionate about the subject as well.
I think I have seen the second question from before. I recognize maybe a short one and. Probably the last one because time limitation. Just raise your question.
My name is Isabel Pansarasa. I'm the Dean of Faculty of Art and Design, Design Field. And I've been listening, it's really impressive. And my question is like, in the, we are trying to talking about disruptive technology. You know, in design field, there's a kind of gradually improved in the past, but incremental or maybe the same as disruptive. Thailand, you know, the country that in the past, and I think, I believe that in the past of Thailand, we can you please give example that some kind of incremental or disruptive technology that belong to our own? Because I feel like now we're talking something so far, you know, we're following the West, and it's just like, it's a very difficult to follow with them. So something that we could get started, something could belong to our own, or something that we have had in the past that disruptive of incremental. And so when we teach the student, we could know the history, we know the route, and we could move, you know, on our own pace, not just kind of like follow the West, which it seems like distance, same fear for all the faculty members to talk about this subject. And if we move on our own pace and we can stand on our own, maybe we could just like, we can do well. You know, that those innovation that I've heard that, like, you know, besides like Steve Jobs, you know, 90% of innovation in the world won't sell either. So what will we talk about? Disruptive, you know, and something distant from us. But can you help me to like define something that close to our own lifestyles?
So, yes, please.
Yeah, a very good question. And I'm sorry that I brought up Steve Jobs because it is rather classic. But in I've been thinking a lot about the society and the economy of Thailand. And when you realize that 40% of our population are farmers, you tend to think, try to find a solution, how to improve farmers. And one way of improving the lives of the farmer is to disrupt the middleman. Disrupt the middleman. Just what we did during the new year that we just had. You know, we all chipped in and buy from directly from our farmers. Now, with the emergence of the e-commerce, the digital online marketing, just the farmers can directly sell to the customers. You can imagine that during the time that we were in this crunch of having too much rice to sell and no milling capacity, we saw that our friends sent us the small milling machines that can be placed at, for example, the convenience store. You bring your husk rice and then deposit, and then out came the milling rice. Right? So that is one of the technologies that can liberate the farmers out of the milling and the middleman. That's one classic example that can happen. Now that would disrupt, of course, the middleman and the miller, because, well, they're more or less one and the same. In our society. So that is one good example. There is another example. For example, in China, not in Thailand, but in China, one large garment manufacturer, instead of building or manufacturing shirts and suits in sizes like S, M, L, XL, they enlist the help of the tailors in the city. And let the tailors measure, take the measurements of their customers. And they produce to the customized, so-called, very good example of a tailor-made. So instead of making, manufacturing the merchandise that would have to, you have to fit into the merchandise. But these manufacturers, they make the merchandise to fit the customers. This is another one of the technology and new innovation in garment manufacturing.
Thank you very much. It is interesting to note that the emergence or the advent of disruptive technology can lead to even disruptive business and disruptive education. I think this gathering or this meeting is very interesting.
the unfortunate thing is that we have had a very limited time.
Can I have one more question?
Okay, I have the third question from the floor.
Thank you very much for giving me the last chance. Oh, actually, I didn't want to ask question, but I want to give my own opinion toward disruptive technology. It seems that we look too far from other country. In my opinion, the best technology are children. If you bring up them very well and pay attention to the young kids, then you don't have to think of technology. The most important people in our country that anyone can do is to pay attention and to educate our kids, especially those babies or very, very young kids. They are very innocent and you can feed in anything that are useful. Why don't we think closer to our family, to the members in our family, and bring up them well? That is the best way, in my opinion. Thank you very much.
Yes.
I hope this will not be last, but not least. Thank you.
Yes. Okay, lastly, I just would like to thank you very much to all the knowledgeable and very much experienced experts, the four experts we have here, as well as the audience who are very attentive to the discussions. So if there is nothing, I just would like to declare the meeting closed. Thank you very much.
We would like to thank all our guest speakers for speaking to us today and all the questions that have been asked. We would now like to ask Dr. Nared to please give souvenirs to our guest speakers and also to invite all university vice presidents, international representatives to please come take a photo up on the stage, please. This building, the Digital Multimedia Complex, building 15, on the first floor. So there is no need for a rush, there is no need to worry because time frame is very flexible. So enjoy your lunch and converse with others.
ขอเรียนเชิญท่านประธานาธิบดีนะคะมอบรางวัลให้กับผู้ทรงคุณวุฒิค่ะท่านแรกค่ะศาสตราจารย์กิตติคุณนายแพทย์สุทธิพรจิตวิทยภาพค่ะประธานกรรมการบริหารสภาวิจัยแห่งชาติค่ะลำดับที่สองค่ะศาสตราจารย์ดร.นายแพทย์ณรัฐพลเจริญพันธุ์ผู้อำนวยการสถาบันชีววิทยาศาสตร์บริกูลมหาวิทยาลัยมหิดลค่ะ ลำดับที่3ค่ะดร.อภารัตน์มหาขันธ์รองผู้ว่าการวิจัยและพัฒนาเพื่อพัฒนาอย่างยั่งยืนสถาบันวิจัยวิทยาศาสตร์และเทคโนโลยีแห่งประเทศไทยค่ะลำดับที่4ค่ะคุณเจนนำชัยสิริประธานสภาอุตสาหกรรมแห่งประเทศไทยค่ะและลำดับสุดท้ายนะคะหม อดิเนเตอร์คนเก่งของเราค่ะคุณเจนนำชัยขอโทษค่ะดร.ธเนศสุจารีกุลค่ะคณะนิติศาสตร์มหาวิทยาลัยรังสิตค่ะและขออนุญาตถ่ายรูปหมู่ร่วมกันค่ะ
Please have a group photo, please. So all international university representatives and vice presidents, please join us on stage.
และรวมถึงผู้บริหารของมหาวิทยาลัยรังสิตค่ะเครือข่ายวิจัยประชาชื่นด้วยค่ะหรือหลายๆท่านนะคะที่วันนี้มาร่วมรับรางวัลนะคะวิจัยนะคะดีเด่นค่ะทั้งระดับชาติและระดับนานาชาติค่ะขอบคุณผู้ทรงคุณวุฒิทุกท่านและแขกผู้มีเกียรติทุกท่านค่ะลำดับต่อไปค่ะจะเป็นพิธีเพื่อมอบรางวัลวิจัยดีเด่นให้แก่นักวิจัยนะคะ
Next we'll be having awards given out to outstanding research conducted by researchers
และเพื่อเป็นเกียรติแก่นักวิจัยนะคะในพิธีการต่อไปค่ะจะขอเรียนเชิญผู้ช่วยศาสตราจารย์ดร.อนุสรณ์ธรรมใจผู้กล่าวรายงานผู้ได้รับรางวัลผลงานวิจัยดีเด่นระดับนานาชาติค่ะ
We would also like to invite Assistant Professor Dr. Anusorn Thammajai to also give our Outstanding Research International Awards.
Chairperson of ISB International Research Conference 2017 Organizing Committee. May I take this opportunity to announce the award winner on research paper and poster presentation in this ISB National and International Research Conference 2017. There are totally 55 international papers and 6 posters. The award have been categorized into 6 fields.Medicine and health science, engineering and technology, architecture and design, humanity and social science, instructional development and research development. On this occasion, may I announce the winner who received the award from the Vice President for Academic Affairs, Dr. Nalay of Rangsit University. International research paper in medicine and health science, the award go toTo long in part is. international research paper in humanity and social science, the award go to Anik Thavichachat. He's poster presentation, the award go to Tuton Gai Suriya Wong.
นีนลวัชชัยมหาวิทยาลัยเทคโนโลยีราชมงคลสุวรรณภูมิและรางวัลดีเด่นดร.วิไลวรรณลีนกุลจากมหาวิทยาลัยเทคโนโลยีราชมงคลพระนคร
ขอเรียนเชิญผู้ได้รับรางวัลทุกท่านนะคะถ่ายรูปหมู่ร่วมกันค่ะและขอเรียนเชิญท่านผู้บริหารของมหาวิทยาลัยรังสิตหรือตัวแทนจากกลุ่มสถาบันนะคะร่วมถ่ายรูปบนเวทีพร้อมกันค่ะ
We will now take a group photo with all recipients. Can all Rutgers University Vice Presidents and International Representatives please come up on stage and take a photo as well?
แขกผู้มีเกียรติทุกท่านนะคะขณะนี้ได้เสร็จสิ้นพิธีเปิดเป็นที่เรียบร้อยแล้วค่ะขอเรียนเชิญทุกท่านรับประทานอาหารกลางวันได้ที่โถง